Merry Christmas, everyone. How's everyone doing today? We're good? Good to be here with you. Would you stand to your feet? Let's sing this song together.
Come, they told me, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, a newborn king to see, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Our finest gifts we bring, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, to lay before the king, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, rum-pa-pum-pum, rum-pa-pum-pum. So to honor him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, when we
everybody. Does it feel a little weird? It's like 92 degrees. We're wearing flannels, pretending. I have friends in Colorado where I used to live who think this is what it's like all the time at Christmas. We're down here sweating with our two guns on our holsters. Our horses are out back. Am I right? I am so glad you're here. If you call Colonial Church home, welcome to the family. Be here to be together. If you're visiting, if you're here visiting family from out of town, if you've just decided to kick the doors of spirituality and check things out this Christmas, if you've been dragged here by a loved one, all those reasons, we're really glad you're here. If you're going to worship the King, you're in the right place. If you want to just sing and soak up the sentimental reasons to be together as family at Christmas, you're in the right place. Ultimately, we want to sing about and to Jesus. So on behalf of everybody here at Colonial, welcome to our Christmas Eve service. Let's keep singing together.
Joy, joy in the Lord is my strength, and oh,
Lord is my strength. The joy, of the Lord is my strength. And oh, 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 he is my hope. The joy, of the Lord is my strength. Come on, let's celebrate, yeah. King of heaven, you stepped from your throne, took on our flesh and made this world your home. Trembling in reverence, Lord, we look above, overcome by such unmerited love. Jesus, my Savior, I bow at your birth, awed by the mercy that brought you to earth, leaving the angels in glorious light for the deep shadows of Bethlehem's night. Oh,
Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore.
Father, we thank you. We just pour out our praise to you today. God, we're so thankful. Lord, we just we recognize today that we celebrate not only your Son coming into the world, but light, our salvation coming with him. And we're so thankful, God, that we can stand here in your presence, call upon your name, and praise you and give thanks, God. And many of us today, maybe we're in this room, maybe by accident. Maybe we were invited and we're not really sure what's happening, but God, we long to hear from you. And maybe there are some here today that as we were singing, that the joy of the Lord is my strength. Maybe today, if we're honest, we're wrestling with how do we find that joy? Maybe you've experienced a loss or experiencing some grief in some way, or maybe just a really hard season. And we sing, God, that the joy, your joy is our strength, God, that you are deeply concerned with the joy that we have. And we can claim that joy today because of your Son, Jesus. We're so thankful, God, that you stepped out of the heavenly realm, out of your throne, stepped down into darkness and dwelt among us, that we too could have life eternal. Father, we just are so thankful. Hear our praises today as we bless your name, Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Everyone said, amen. Thanks so much for singing. You guys can have a seat.
Well, again, Merry Christmas. My name is Loren, and I'm one of the pastors here at Colonial. I can only imagine the many places we have come from, both maybe geographically as well as just habits or motivation to be in church on a hot Friday afternoon. Some of us have been looking forward to this. I know I have been. I know we got a bunch of kids in here. I'm not going to talk nearly as long today, okay, for any of you worried about my long-windedness. I heard a few claps over here. I heard that. I do want to make sure you know, especially if this is not where you normally find yourselves, we at Colonial are so glad you're here, and we want you to know our door's wide open. Always welcome to be a part of what we're doing. Specifically, the best way to get any information about our church, yes, we have a website. That's probably the easiest thing to do, but we really funnel all of our information, all the things we do for the kids, all the way up through our adults, for parents, for everything we do on the weekends and throughout the year through our app. So if you real easily want to go to the Google Play Store or the App Store, even in the middle of us talking, we will not judge you if you want to download that app. And there's a connect button on the bottom. And if you hit that, that's all I'm going to say is there's going to be some real intuitive things you can do to ask questions, to submit prayer requests, to find out what's going on in the new year. In fact, on that note, I want to make sure this is crystal clear, because one of you, I don't know who it's going to be, is going to show up Sunday, and the doors are going to be locked, the lights are going to be off, and you're going to wonder what happened. It's because you fell asleep right now. We are not having church services here at Colonial this Sunday. We actually have a unique schedule. Yeah, we have our two services today on Christmas Eve, but we take the last weekend of the year and call it a Sabbath weekend, a rest weekend for the whole church. A lot of churches don't do that. We've done that the last several years, and our people love it. So many people working these cameras, working on the stage, working in our kids' ministry over in Building 242, the people that welcomed you as you came in our doors, our staff, everybody just takes a big breath and rests on Sunday and is with family, and I hope you do the same. And so this Sunday, we will not be having services. The next week, the first Sunday of the new year, we're only going to have one service because we know everybody's still not quite back into the rhythm. Kids won't even have gone back to school yet. So the 2nd of January, the following Sunday, we're going to have one service at 11 a.m. And then after that, we get back into our regular rhythm of 9:15, 11, 9:15, 11, 9:15, 11. So that's probably confusing, but hopefully that makes some sense to you. Don't come this Sunday. Come the next Sunday at 11 o'clock. Also, because we're not going to be in this place on our campus until the next year, I definitely want to make sure I say this logistical announcement really quickly. For anybody who gives and who some of us care about which tax year the giving is in, every nonprofit, every church deals with the same things. We get questions all the time. Here's the simple answer to the question is if you want to give and make sure it's on their 2021 giving, then you need to either give it through our app, give it through our wall boxes, or mail a check, or and make sure it's postmarked by the 31st of December. Intuitively makes sense, but I want to throw that out there so you know about our year-end giving clarity. Finally, if there's one thing that I want to make sure our visitors know about, or maybe you're just new to Colonial in the last few months, in fact, I'll bet, I hope this is true, I'll bet one or more of you goes home today and you decide, you know what, it's been a while since I've been in church. I really enjoyed that. I want to go back in the new year. Or you think about your family and you're like, you know, I think I want my family more connected to the faith community. I want to come back to church. I want to come back to Colonial in the new year. If there's one thing I can point you toward besides our Sunday morning services, which is real obvious, we have a lunch for you. We have a thing we call More About Colonial later in January, where we have a free lunch for as many people as come. We had 70-something people at one of them earlier in the fall. We had about 15 at our last one. Who knows how many are going to sign up over the holidays and in the new year, but you are welcome to come on the 23rd of January, right after our second service. We'll have a free lunch for everybody. Our staff will be there. We'll answer questions. We'll share kind of the heart and the vision of our church, and you'll just get to meet maybe even some other new people too. So kids are welcome. We'll have food and activities for the little ones as well. Just put that on your radar, especially if you leave in a little while today and you go home and you have that conversation with yourself or with people you care about. I think I want to come back in the new year. That's the place to really make sure you don't miss More About Colonial. Okay, enough of me talking about that. I want to read two very short passages out of the Christmas story from the Gospel of Luke chapter 2. And this first one is probably going to seem very familiar to a lot of us. This is from Luke chapter 2, just verse 7. This is about Mary. It says, she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them. Probably sounds really familiar, doesn't it? I want to go down the same page later in the same chapter of the Gospel of Luke, and I want to read about a moment in the Christmas story that I'll bet a lot of us haven't heard or don't pay much attention to. There's this old Jewish priest who comes along Mary and Joseph and the little baby, and he prays a blessing over them. And listen to what he says. It says, Simeon blessed them. And then he said to Mary, the baby's mother, this child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall and many others to rise. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your very soul. Now, if you take the time to read this whole chapter, which, by the way, I totally think you should, whether it's tonight, sitting down by yourself, or maybe with your family, or in the morning, maybe as a Christmas new tradition, to read the second chapter of Luke. Read the whole chapter. I just read two little blurbs. If you do that, you might just catch a theme. You might just catch a theme that the writer was trying to communicate, and if you do catch it, it might even be a little sobering, possibly even a big bummer. In fact, I want to go ahead and spoil it for you. Luke records the Christmas story for us and basically writes that Jesus came to be rejected. I don't know if you think that when it comes to Christmas, but this is the truth. Jesus came to be rejected. When we read the Gospel of Luke, he's not just recording the facts here, the play-by-play, the what, when, how, all that stuff. I mean, he's doing that, but he's also teaching us something. He's showing us, the readers, even 2,000 years later, he's showing us something. He's teaching us that Jesus came to be rejected. Even in that first passage we read, let me read it again. She, Mary, gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, an animal trough, because there was no lodging available for them. Even there, it's not just facts. Look more closely with me. Jesus was rejected even while he was in the womb. He hadn't even been born yet. And he's pushed away. There's no room for them. And Mary and Joseph, they had to resort to a barn, or more likely a little cave of some sorts. There's no room. There's a manger. There's an animal trough. They're out in the cold. And then later in the chapter, they come across this old devout Jewish priest. His name's Simeon. And what I didn't read, but what you need to know, is that he had been promised long before. God told him, someday, before you die, you are going to lay your own eyes on the Savior of the world, the Messiah, the Christ. You're going to get to see him. I'm not going to let you die until you see him. So I don't know what that sense of anticipation was like for him, but we read this, and we can picture Simeon taking the infant. I can picture him holding him up like Rafiki in The Lion King, you know? And we've got his quote here in verse 29. Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace, as you have promised. I have seen your salvation. Mary and Joseph are probably like, okay, that's enough. Let me have him back. And then Simeon turns to Mary. Listen to this. And moms, if you didn't catch it the first time, moms, listen to if these words were said about your little baby. Even dads, listen if you heard someone speak over your newborn with these words. Simeon said, this child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall and many others to rise. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. How's that sit, parents? A lot of people are going to be against your kid. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your very soul. This is going to hurt. Jesus came to be rejected. He came to make, evidently, some people upset. He came to reveal where people's hearts are and have them speak out against him. He came to be shut out. He came to be rejected, which begs the question today, why? Did Jesus just love the experience of rejection? I mean, I guess there are some people in our lives that I've come across a few that seem to seek out rejection. I would call that dysfunction, right? I would call that some lack of health. No, Jesus came, this is even crazier than dysfunction. Jesus came knowing he would be rejected and embracing rejection because it was central to why he came. I'll be this bold. If we don't understand this, we really don't understand Christmas. I really believe that. If we don't understand this, we really don't understand Christmas. Let's take a quick look at three reasons why Jesus was rejected. Okay, why was Jesus rejected? Well, first of all, Jesus is all about the inside. Just take a look historically at Jesus with me. Let's go there for a minute. He just didn't measure up on the outside. He wasn't the right kind of Messiah or Christ or King. He didn't meet the world's standards. Jesus actually came to the wrong side of the tracks. Did you know that? Mary and Joseph, history tells us, when they took their baby, a few days old, to the Jewish temple, like every good Jewish couple, to have him circumcised, to make an offering to the temple, like every devout Jewish family did, they brought a couple little birds. They were either pigeons or doves. Either way, that's what the poorest of the poor made for their offering. Other people who had more, they gave more. They gave other things. But the poorest of the poor brought either a couple of pigeons or a couple of doves. Joseph was a carpenter. He's a blue-collar worker. Jesus grew up in this home. Nobody from the outside looked at him and went, that's a leader. Nobody said that about Jesus. Some people in his family, surely, and in his small hometown where everybody talks, surely even called him illegitimate. I mean, you know how it is. Two people get married, and then 4, 5, 6 months later, they have a baby, and everybody goes, oh, I can do the math, right? For all kinds of reasons, people looked at Jesus and they thought, this guy's not leadership material. He's an illegitimate kid. He's from a poor family. He's from the wrong side of the tracks. He has no connections. And did you know this? We know that he was not good looking. I don't know what movies you've watched about Jesus or what images you have in your head, but he was not good looking. I can say that with confidence. The Bible says there was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected. He wasn't good looking. Think about this. What is a celebrity in our culture? We live in a celebrity culture, don't we? What is a celebrity? A celebrity is someone who has it all together on the outside, even if on the inside they're a hot mess, right? That's what a celebrity is. What's important is on the outside. They're amazing. They're beautiful, or they're talented, or maybe both. People who have amazing character on the inside, but who are just ordinary on the outside, those are not our celebrities, with rare exceptions, right? Those are not our celebrities. It's the externals, it's the superficial, it's the image on the outside that makes someone in our culture everybody looks to for leadership, everybody talks about. Jesus came 2,000 years ago and flipped that on its head. Jesus said your status, your beauty, your connections, maybe in today's terms, how many likes or followers you have, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. What's on the outside doesn't matter. What matters is the inside, your heart. In fact, if you read the teachings of Jesus, if you watch the life of Jesus as on display throughout the Gospels, we just see him over and over again go back to it's what's on the inside that matters. If we go to the Old Testament, if we go way back in time, we can read about how Samuel was given this huge special task to go find the man who would be the first king ever of the nation of Israel. Talk about a pretty cool assignment, right? And so he goes on this search to find the first king of Israel, and he finally finds his man, who happens to be tall, dark, and handsome. And God actually says, no. Let me read this to you. Lord said to Samuel, "Don't judge by his appearance or height, for I have rejected him." The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Christmas means for us who call ourselves Christians, pride, arrogance, judgment, comparison, it should be the last things we're associated with. That should be the last thing people think of us when they think of Christians. The spirit of Christmas is the opposite of this. Christians are to care about what's on the inside. If we're followers of Jesus, we are to care about wisdom, about integrity, about compassion, about patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control. We're not to care nearly as much. This should be those things I just mentioned. We should care about being ripped about right here, right? About being tan, about having the right clothes and the right cars. As Christians, we see that underneath the plain, ordinary outer appearance of Jesus is a beauty like no other. As Christians, we are to say, I'm never going to get fooled by the outer appearance. I would put it this way. To be a Christian is to have an X-ray worldview. It's kind of a goofy way of saying it, but if we're going to follow Jesus, if we're going to follow his ways, if we're going to live like him, we're going to be people who look not at the outside, but we're going to look at the heart. We're going to be people who long to be transformed on the inside ourselves. Jesus evidently was really ordinary. He didn't measure up on the outside. He was all about the heart. Why was he rejected? He's all about the inside. Secondly, he showed people who they were, and they did not like it. We can see this over and over again. Jesus showed people who they were on the inside, and they did not like it. We can read later in the New Testament in Romans chapter 1 that says very clearly that everybody, all of humanity, knows down deep inside we need God. Everybody, Romans 1 tells us, knows down deep inside we're all a hot mess. We're all broken. We're all rebels. We're all living for ourselves. We need God. We need God's forgiveness. We need God's life. But we all have this amazing way, I would say, of justifying our actions, justifying our attitudes. I know I do. I'm really good at it. We suppress the truth. We ignore our own stuff. I'm so much better at pointing everybody else's out. at least finding a few people that I feel like I'm better than, and I just suppress that truth, that reality of my own sinfulness, my own depravity, and anything that comes along that makes it hard for me to suppress that truth, I push away from. I resist. I resent. In fact, I maybe even get upset about. Anything that makes it hard for us to suppress this riles us up. It upsets us. It maybe even makes us angry, which helps me understand why a lot of people did not like Jesus. Christmas time, that's a weird thing to say, right? He's an innocent baby. What did he do to make anybody mad? But we're looking at who Jesus was even before he came in the form of a child. Jesus made it very difficult for people to ignore what was going on the inside of themselves, to ignore their own depravity and admit to themselves their very real need for God. For those of us who would call ourselves followers of him today, we are going to experience that same kind of rejection. This is another truth that we can get from the Christmas story, I even believe. What happened, for example, when Herod was the puppet king. At the time of Jesus' birth, the Roman Empire ruled. Israel was occupied by the Empire of Rome, but they let the Jews kind of have their figurehead king. Let him have a palace, let him have a bunch of stuff, and his name was Herod, and he was kind of their puppet king. And Herod heard at one point that people were saying that Jesus had come and Jesus was going to be the new king. And he found out that Jesus had been born roughly in the last couple years. So you know what Herod did? He had all the male children, 2 years old and younger, slaughtered. All of them. And scholars debate how many of those deaths occurred. It's historically called the Massacre of Innocents. If it was just the little village of Bethlehem, some scholars estimate it was 6 to 12 kids. Other historians say, no, it was a broader region. It was tens of thousands of little boys. Either way, tragedy. Just absolutely awful. Jesus came into the world, and Herod did not want to be reminded that he was not the real king. I can relate to that. I don't want to be reminded that I'm not the real king of my life either. So I get upset, I rebel, I push away. Anyone who follows and lives anything like Jesus is going to be rejected as well. It makes me think of a couple of friends of mine. It makes me think, first of all, of a friend of mine who now works for Homeland Security. I have a buddy who, he started as a cop in Houston, in HPD, and when he was a young police officer, kind of finding his way, he found out that they weren't supposed to go to a particular neighborhood over here and a couple corners over there. And he found out there was a bucket of money that would show up. And if he just took a little bit and just avoided those areas, turns out it was being supplied by some local drug dealers. And it really upset him. He was young in his faith. He was trying to live out his life, honoring the Lord in every little choice he made. And he refused to take any of the money. And I remember him telling me about this, and he said, man, I almost lost my job. And I always worried I might lose more than that. I thought that was just in the movies, you know? Makes me think of another friend that to this day, he's in construction, and he refuses to cut corners. He works every day like he's working for the king, and he refuses to hire subpar workers. He refuses to purchase cheaper supplies. And he's doing really well because I think the Lord's blessing him, but over and over again, over time, he has lost out on projects. He's lost out on bids because somebody will come along and do the same job, but do it for cheaper. I'll get more personal. I think back to when I was in high school, before I was a Christian, and I think of the small group of students I was with my junior and senior year where we all took trigonometry, we called it trig, and then calculus, and it was all of us in the same class, so we all did math for a couple years. And Rick was in that class, and he was a Christian. I didn't know Rick very well. But I'm not proud of this, but I'll just say it out loud. The rest of us just cheated our way through trig and calculus. Oh, my goodness. I don't know how many times we were copying each other's homework, cheating on tests, doing really well. And I remember people trying to get Rick to do it with us, and he wouldn't. And I remember worried that Rick was going to get us in trouble. And I remember people making fun of Rick, myself included. The manger means that if you live anything like Jesus, there won't be room for you in a whole bunch of places. This is part of the meaning of Christmas. We don't have to be Jesus to be rejected. If we simply follow him and live anything like him, we're going to face rejection. Okay, that's us. Back to Jesus. Why was Jesus rejected? He was rejected because he was all about the inside. He was rejected because he showed people who they were and they didn't like it. And lastly, and I would say most importantly, why was he rejected? Can we go back and look at that prediction, that ancient prediction about Jesus? And can you just lean in a little bit? I want to read the whole paragraph here. Listen to these words. This is so central to Christianity. Lean in with me. This is about Jesus, and this is about us. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised, and we did not care. Yet it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced. This is where he's talking about the cross that would come. He was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us like sheep have strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own, yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. In short, what's Isaiah saying? Hundreds of years before Jesus. Catch this. This is the good news of Christmas. As serious as this has been, this is the good news of Christmas. The rejection of Jesus is our acceptance. He didn't come to be rejected just so we'd have an example to follow. No. He came to be rejected as our Savior. What does it say? He was beaten so we could be made whole. This is great news. He was whipped so we could be healed. Merry Christmas. His rejection is our acceptance. What did the old man, Simeon, say of Jesus? He said this to Mary and Joseph, the parents, about this little baby. He said, he will be opposed. There's going to be a lot of people against him because Jesus is spoken against, we can be spoken for. That's good news. Because Jesus was rejected, we can be accepted. Because there was no room for Jesus, we get to be with God, with him forever. This is the good news. This is the history-changing, life-impacting, beautiful, historic gospel of Jesus. Merry Christmas. Pray with me. Father, I'm so grateful to you, first of all, for Christmas. I love this season. I love that I get to be with people I love dearly. I get to exchange gifts and laugh and eat healthy food and a lot of unhealthy food and just be together. I know it's hard for a lot of us, too, as we miss people that have spent Christmas with us before. Lord, I thank you for the sentimental, feel-good nature of the holidays. And yet, Father, I thank you for bringing the real meaning of Christmas to life for me and for so many of us. We just recognize what you have done. We recognize why you have done it. Forgive us for the times we question your goodness, your generosity, your love, your mercy, because there is proof in the Christmas story of how far you are willing to go to make a way back to you for us. Thank you. God, I lift up everybody who's here, everybody who's watching with us online. I pray, Father, wherever they are, that you would meet them in a supernatural way. For those that need so desperately to find comfort in hard times with you, I pray that you would supernaturally provide them comfort. for those who are just desperate for friendship, for community. I pray that you would use Colonial Church and other churches to meet that need, Father, that we would get to journey with each other. And most importantly, Father, for anyone who just longs to know you in a personal way, to learn to trust you and follow you, and to live this life that you have meant for each of us to live, I pray that you would give them courage to take that leap of faith with all of their unanswered questions, with all of their skepticism, with a hope that this is true, that you have chosen rejection for our acceptance. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, so much. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, the coming King. Amen.
Real.
So as you came in, you were handed a candle. I believe you've got one. And this is kind of the part in our service where we want to light a candle, and we want to represent the light that Christ brought into the world. This isn't just a tradition. This isn't just something that we just always do. This is with intentionality, great intentionality that we do this. I believe that we worship both in spirit and also in the flesh too. And so this is an opportunity for us to worship with a visual representation. Sometimes words fail us, and that's the reason God created the world in this beauty. Because sometimes all it takes is to step outside of our circumstance to see something new with new eyes right in front of us. And that calls our attention. And so this is what we're doing. We are calling ourselves, our hearts, our minds into attention, into focusing on the Spirit of God here in this place with us. And so we're going to have them kind of bringing, they're going to bring, come down, they're going to light their candles, our greeters are, the candles from the stage, and they're going to start coming up the aisles and just begin to light. And as you light yours, would you just light your neighbor's and just pass the light on? And we will just hold this as a reminder as we also lift up the name of Jesus.
I see. Merry Christmas, everybody. We hope you've had a good experience. We hope, even more important, that you've encountered the God we know is real, we know is good. As you leave today, I hope you have a really special time with people that you care about, that care about you. We hope that you know our doors are wide open if you want to journey with us as we chase after Jesus the King in the new year. Don't come Sunday. Come a week from Sunday at 11 o'clock. Merry Christmas, everybody.